Pero Jorge, digo.
Hello everyone and welcome to a new web seminar, the number 23 of our series of the Latin American webinars on physics. My name is Jorge Diaz from the Carlsruhe Institute of Technology, and I will be your host today. Our speaker today is Carlos Argüelles from MIT, who will talk about the star neutrinos and IceCube. Carlos received his PhD from the University of Wisconsin in Madison, and now he's a postdoc at MIT working on IceCube in the IceCube-86 telescope. Carlos' talk today is titled Results from the Search of eV-Sterile Neutrinos with IceCube. We're really glad to having him as a speaker today. And I remind you that you can be part of this discussion, writing questions on the questions and comments using the Q&A system. So remember that you can be part of all of this. I will now hand you over Carlos. So Carlos, all yours.
Thank you, Jorge. Yes, today I will go to talk to you about our latest stellar neutrino analysis. I'm going to go into details of the analysis, and you can actually now read about this result. It's in the archive numbers in the bottom of this slide. And so please check it out. And at the end, of course, there will be time for discussions and questions. OK, so the menu for today, we are going to go over three topics. The first thing we are going to discuss is a very fast review of neutrino oscillations. And the MSW effect is going to be very important in the IceCube and neutrino search. Then I'm going to explain you how IceCube works. And then the bulk of my talk, most of it, is going to be on the actual stellar neutrino search that we have performed with 1 year of data. So let's start with neutrino oscillations. So neutrino oscillations in two generations follow a very simple prescription. The oscillation probability, or rather the survival probability, of a neutrino that starts with a flavor alpha and remains of that flavor alpha after it travels a distance L and has an energy E, is given by this formula. And it's controlled by two parameters. One is the sine squared to theta, which is going to gauge the amplitude of the oscillation. And the other parameter is the delta M squared, which is going to control the frequency of the oscillation. So in this little cartoon down there, you can see, like, if I start, for example, with a pure new mu state, as it travels, it can transform to a new E and go back to new mu. And the two parameters will control amplitude and oscillation, respectively. So why does this happen? So why do neutrinos oscillate in this fashion? Well, our current picture is that the so-called mass eigenstates, which are the vacuum propagation eigenstates, and the flavor eigenstates are not the same. They are actually related by the PMNS matrix, or the lepton mixing matrix, here represented with this letter U. And the lepton mixing matrix U, you can see that it has a very large off-diagonal component, so it allows for very large flavor transitions. And like the CKM matrix, it's quite non-diagonal. We usually parameterize this matrix as a function of three angles and one CP phase. We have measured with reasonably good accuracy these three angles, and the CP phase is yet to be measured. So then we have three massive neutrinos, and of course there's going to be some mass splitting between them. And there is a smaller mass splitting between the, what we call the neutrino 1 and neutrino 2, which is the solar mass split, which was measured first in solar experiments, and that is around 10 to the minus 5. And then there is a larger mass splitting between the first and second mass eigenstates and the third eigenstate, which was measured first in atmospheric neutrino experiments, and that is around 10 to the minus 3 electron volt squared. The solar mass splitting, we know its sign, but the atmospheric mass splitting sign is not known. And this gives rise to a neutrino ordering problem, which is just to say if the mass against, say, 3 is heavier or lighter than the 1 or 2. And so this, you know, this very simple equations in this picture actually describes most of the data we have. And then there are only two remaining pieces in this picture. One of them is what's the value of the CP phase, and the other one is what's the sign of delta M squared atmospheric, which is the neutrino ordering problem. And the next generation experiments in neutrino physics are aiming to to measure these two quantities. Okay, but there are pieces that don't fit, right? This puzzle has some pieces that don't quite match what we expect, and the most striking perhaps evidence, or the most significant evidence rather, of something that doesn't fit is the LSND experiment. And the LSND experiment was a new mu bar, I'm sorry, a new mu to nu e experiment, and it saw some excess of events. So in the left plot, you can see the distribution of events that LSND had as a function of L over E. Those are these black data points. And the background expectation that LSND had for new E appearance was the green and red histograms. And you can see the green and red histograms cannot explain the data, so the black dots. And so you need to add a third component that comes from new mu bar, new E oscillations, and that is the blue histogram in that plot. And then using the first formula we discussed, you can convert that particular excess into a parameter space of the mixing angle and the mass coreference. So if you do that, you end up with this plot, which is has in the y-axis delta m squared and the x-axis sine squared to theta. And so the green region is the region that's compatible with the data on the left plot. And you can see what's striking is that the delta m squared that's required to explain this anomaly is significantly different from the atmospheric and solar mass delta m squared that we have already measured. And we can only have, of course, two mass square difference when we have three neutrinos. So this is a problem, right? And the solution of this problem, one of the solutions is that we include a fourth neutrino, and that neutrino happens to have around 1 eV square of the mass difference. And so we have seen some anomalies in the, you know, electron appearance in between E. There have been some claim of some of this disappearance anomalies in reactor experiments, for example. But if you observe electron appearance, then the product of U mu 4, U e 4 must be non-vanishing, and that implies automatically that you must also observe muon disappearance, like we have so-called seen electron disappearance. And so far we have done long-based experiments, and other experiments have searched for muon disappearance, but we have not found it. And so IceCube is going to try to see if there is muon disappearance compatible to one electron volt square stellar neutrino, to see if this picture makes sense. So how do we introduce this extrasolar neutrino? Well, when one does this, one puts a four neutrino mass eigenstate that can be lighter or heavier than the active neutrinos. So you want to introduce one mass split in three angles and two CP phases. And so usually we talked about what we call a 3+1 model, where the three active neutrinos are more or less in a degenerate state because the mass splitting is so much smaller than the stellar neutrino mass splitting. So we can also talk about a 1+3 model, where the stellar neutrino is lighter than the active ones. Okay, so what does the word say about this model, this picture? Well, there is very large tension. So if you look at the left plot for a paper by Jochen Kopp, you can see here the effective nu-mu-nu-e angle. So the blue line is the 99% exclusion, exclude everything to the right of it. And the solution for the LSND and reactors and so on are these red balloons. And you can see that the red balloons are to the right of the blue line. So that means that there is a tension between the experiments that have not seen stellar neutrino-like signatures and the ones that claim signatures. So one can subtract, you know, the red minus the blue lines and do a global fit to put it all together. And we did that very recently with Gabriel Collins and collaborators. And we find that there are still some solutions that remain after you do the subtraction processes. And this is shown in the right figure. But okay, so the anomalies still remain after one considers, you know, updated data. So what we need to do is we need new measurements to really disentangle what's going on here. So let me introduce what we're going to use in IceCube, very simplified model. And so as I was telling you, the stellar neutrino can be actively heavier or lighter than the active one. So if it's heavier, we call it a 3+1 model. And if it's lighter, we call it a 1+3 model. So cosmology doesn't like to have large neutrino, some of neutrino masses, at least in the 1 eV square, one electron volt size. And so that puts more strong constraints in the 1+3 model. So we are going to think about, in what follows in these talks, in 3+1 models, where the stellar neutrino is heavier than the active neutrinos. And so when one introduces stellar neutrinos, I was saying, you introduce three angles and two extra CP phases. So for simplicity, we're going to set all CP phases to zero. And then there are three angles, so we have to do something about that. So what we decided to do is set two of them to zero and only take into account theta to four. And there are good reasons to do this, but perhaps one of the nicest things is that if you take these assumptions, then sine squared to theta to four is exactly the same as sine squared to theta mu, which is the amplitude of mu disappearance in vacuum. So it has a very nice interpretation. Okay. So how does IceCube connect to this short baseline anomaly, also this LSD problem? So in this figure, in the x-axis, I have the neutrino energy in GeVs. And in the y-axis, in the left one, I have the baseline in inverse GeV. And in the right one, the baseline in meters. And this plot is made such that if you go to the upper corner, that it should be 12,000 kilometers, that's the diameter of the Earth. And so what you basically tell you is, like, if you want to observe one given mass square difference, you need to put yourself in the correct baseline to see the first oscillation. So for example, if I want to look at the solar mass splitting, I have to be in the L, little sun symbol, which you can see crosses the Kamlan experiment region, which is an experiment that has order MeV energies and hundreds of kilometers, and is in the right position to see that particular oscillation length. Now, if I want to look at atmospheric mass splitting, then I have to be at a different baseline, and that's given by this dashed line, dotted dashed line. And you can see that line then crosses Super Kamiokande, which measures neutrinos in the GeV, and hundreds of kilometers, and it also crosses this cluster of experiments that were tuned to look at this particular oscillation baseline. Now, in pink color, I put the experiments that actually claim some signal of anomalous behavior compatible to one eV² stellar neutrino. And so then I can draw the baseline that will be required to observe that if the stellar neutrino mass difference will be one eV², which is this dotted line. And you can see that this line, you know, crosses more or less the experiments in the short baseline anomalies, and then it's going to keep going, and it's going to cross the ice cube regime, which is basically a very high energy, very high baseline, very long baseline regime. And so that means that if one believes on this L over E scaling of the oscillations, right, that means that the short baseline anomalies are a counterpart of the ice cube, or rather, ice cube will be the counterpart of the short baseline anomaly in high energy long baselines. So they should be compatible if they see oscillations. Okay. So what does IceCube typically observe is atmospheric neutrinos, right? Atmospheric neutrinos are producing cosmic ray showers in the atmosphere. We know the flavor composition of the initial neutrinos and the amount of anti-gravity neutrinos. And basically, they're going to interact in various directions. And the directions we can parameterize with what we call the zenith angle, which is the angle represented in this little diagram. So zenith angle equal to pi, or cos theta equal to minus 1. It means that the neutrinos will go through the crust, the mantle, and the core, and then reach ice cube as they cross the whole Earth. And as one decreases the zenith angle, the neutrinos will have a smaller baseline and cross different Earth layers. So why am I making a point here that the neutrinos will cross different Earth layers for different baselines? And the important point is the following, that in matter, there is a so-called Migajev-Smirnov-Wolfenstein effect. And what this means is that the oscillation probability will actually modify in the presence of matter. And so the oscillation formula follows the first equation here, so it has the same shape as the vacuum equation, but now we have modified the mixing angle and the mass square difference with the presence of matter. So what's notable here is that if you look at the formula for the tangent of the two times the mixing angle in matter, that has a denominator that if you make it zero, it will make sine squared to theta maximal, so it's one. And that will happen in a very specific condition. So here A is the matter potential term. So when that denominator is zero, you will get this resonant enhancement, so-called MSW resonance. And so the resonant flavor transition actually will happen when the resonant energy, which is this bottom line equation, is equal to these parameters here, so it will depend linearly on the delta m squared, and you have to, it has two signs, the first upper sign, the minus sign, is for neutrinos, and the lower sign is for antineutrinos. And so you can see that if we have assumed a 3 plus 1 model, so the stellar neutrino is heavier, delta m squared is positive, so the only way to satisfy this equation is to choose the plus sign. So what's going to happen is that for some particular densities where this condition is satisfied, there will be an enhancement between active and stellar antineutrino transitions. So how does this look? So this is kind of a stroke of light, but if you take delta m squared to be one electron volt, and then you take the Earth's core density, and you plug this into this equation, you get that this energy comes around 1 TeV. And this is going to be very very lucky number, because IceCube is very effective at measuring neutrinos in that particular energy range. And so this was pointed out for the first time by Nuno Kawa and collaborators in 2003. And the way this looks is like here in this plot, I have the neutrino energy in the x-axis and the probabilities in the y-axis. And the blue lines are the neutrino, the muon neutrino probabilities. The dashed ones are actually the muon neutrino probabilities, and they go to 1 as the energy increases, as one would expect. But the solid blue ones are the antineutrino survival probabilities. And as you can see, as one approaches this MSW resonance somewhere around a couple of TeVs, one gets this massive conversion between new mu bars into basically sterols and so on. So this MSW resonance effect is the effect that we're going to try to look for in this analysis. So let me shift gears a little bit and talk about IceCube. So while IceCube is in the South Pole is a very large place, so here's a comparison to the US. So it's all the way over there, it's in the surface of the South Pole. There is the South Pole, the IceCube lab, which looks like this. But the IceCube, actually, most of it is not in this lab, as you know. Most of the experiment is about 1 kilometer and a half below the ice, and we have instrumented basically 1 cubic kilometer of ice with PMTs. And the way that we have done is we have arranged them in strings. As we have 86 strings on which we have domes separated 70 meters apart, so 60 domes per string. Each dome contains one PMT that, of course, can convert light into charge. And then we have a digitalization signal inside the dome. And then the signal goes through the cable, and we can process in the IceCube lab station. And then we ship it to mice, somewhere we actually do our post-processing. So IceCube, I think, is quite famous now for discovering the high-energy neutrinos, so the astrophysical neutrinos. And the way we did that is we looked for events that started within the detector and did not deposit any light in a Vito region that was adequately defined. And then we looked at the events that deposited a very large amount of energy in the fiducial volume of the detector. So what you can see here in this plot is the deposited energy in TeVs, and here the backgrounds are the pink line at most. And you can see that as one increases the energy, you see this hard component, you know, showing up very, very clearly. And the two highest events here are Bear and Ernie, so we name our high energy astrophysical events by Muppet names, and this happens to be these two ones. But IceCube, I mean, has discovered astrophysical neutrinos. We have also found evidence of these neutrinos through true-going muons. And so what are those events? So in this case, you know, the detector is like this square, and a neutrino is coming somewhere through the Earth, and it may interact inside the detector, like in the previous analysis, but it also may, and typically does, interact outside the detector. And so then it will produce a muon, and the muon will reach the detector, and you will not see the starting point of the neutrino. So in these cases, you can see the geometry of the light deposition, and that allows us to measure the angular direction of the neutrino to about 1 degree, a little better, actually. And then we can still measure the energy. We have a measurement of the neutrino energy by looking at the energy deposition of the muons. So in this upper right equation, I have the beta block formula, and you can see that at the hundreds of GeVs, the energy of the muon and the dEdx of the muon start to have this linear relationship, right? And so that means that if we can measure the dEdx, then we can have a proxy for the muon energy, and from that we can then extract the neutrino energy. And so how this actually looks in our reconstructed quantities is shown in this plot in the lower right panel. And so you can see the muon energy proxy, there's our estimation of the muon energy, and the y-axis is the neutrino energy. And about 1 TeV, they start having this linear relationship expected by muon energy losses process. So basically, by looking at the geometry, we can look at the direction pretty well, and by looking at the energy position, we can get an estimation of the energy. So this is how one of these true going events look like. Here, each little dot is one of our DOMs, and then the balloon size is the amount of charge deposit. So the bigger the balloon, the more charge was deposited. And the color specifies the time. So red is earlier times and blue is later times. So that means that this event started somewhere in the bottom of the detector and made its way up to the top. We have this particular direction. And again, what we do is basically we can obtain this direction, which is the red line here, is our best fit reconstruction direction by minimizing on the geometry and time of this charge deposition. And then by looking at the energy position along this line, we can estimate the energy. OK, so there was an analysis that was published in PRL some years ago that we looked for these high energy neutrinos. It contains about 20,000 events. And we are going to base our analysis on this particular analysis. And this is how the distribution of this true going mu events looks in energy. So in the high energy tail, these are dominated by the mapped neutrinos. So the astrophysical components there is very strong. Then if one looks at lower energies, then it's mostly dominated by these non-mapped atmospheric neutrinos. And of these neutrinos, we have actually used the lower energy ones, not in this particular cut selection, another selection, but we have used these low energy neutrinos with deep core to actually measure the standard atmospheric parameters pretty well. We have published this in PRD last year. So let me just hop to where stereoneutrino search exists. So stereoneutrino search analysis lives in the middle of this distribution, right? It's neither in the low energy tail where the standard oscillation happens or the high energy tail where the astrophysical neutrinos are being observed. It's in the middle of the distribution, and the reason is that, again, there is this amazing coincidence that if you take one electron volt squared stellar neutrino mass difference, you happen to have a resonance energy around the middle of this distribution. So it's a very good place to make a measurement because we have lots of data that we can use to constrain this. Okay, so this is where we are going to leave. So it's going to be a little more complicated than just looking at the energy distribution. We actually use information from the direction and the energy. So what's going to happen is like, you can see here a little air diagram, neutrinos can come from different directions. So if they come from where the blue arrow points, that's cos theta equal minus 1. And if they come from the green arrow, where the green arrow comes, that's cos theta equal 0. So then I can plot these so-called oscillograms, where in the y and x or in the horizontal axis, I have the cosine of the angle. So the, where the blue arrow points, is it means neutrinos go through the earth. And where the green arrow points, these neutrinos just come through the horizon. I have the oscillogram for both neutrinos and antineutrinos. So one thing that you can see already is that if I am at very high energies and I'm crossing the earth, neutrinos get absorbed by the earth. It's just the earth opacity, which is this blue corner in both neutrinos and antineutrinos. And then the other striking feature is that for antineutrinos, as we have promised, there is going to be this MSW conversion around a TeV. And this happens for these parameters that are L and D minimum like. And so what we are going to try to do is we are going to try to identify this resonance. And so how does this resonance depend on the stereoneutrino parameters? Well, it's a simple relationship is that the resonant energy is linearly proportional to delta M squared, as you can see in the equation up here. So that means that if I increase my delta M squared, my blob, this blue depletion in antineutrinos will go higher in energies. And if I make it smaller, it will go smaller in energy. The angle of stereoneutrinos is small, so cos theta to 1 is close to 1 as a sublinear effect. But basically, we have very good handle on the delta M squared. OK. So this, of course, is not so beautiful when one actually looks at this and reconstructed of quantities, where this is energies, meaning or any resolution is good, but not amazing. So in this plot, I show in the upper left panel is my parameter space. I have again sine squared 2 to the 4. That's the amplitude in vacuum, and then delta m squared for 1 is the y-axis. And then I plot, in this case, this gray balloon, which is a representation of the LSD minimum anomaly solution. And then I pick three parameter points here. It's like this label with the stars 1, 2, 3. And for example, if I'm at parameter point 1, then the effect that I see, or the difference that I see with respect to my hypothesis, is shown in the right upper panel, labeled by 1. And you can see that it makes a dip somewhere around the air crossing direction, so cos theta equal minus 1, and it's a 10% effect, and it has this very specific energy ceiling correlation. Now, if I move from 1 to 2, then the MSW energy goes down, so I expect my disappearance to happen at lower energies, so which is what you see in the second panel. And now if I move to 0.3 has a bigger angle, so the effects, the vacuumizations are more stronger, and so you have a stronger effect, and also it happens at a little higher energies because we have increased delta m squared. So basically, for each point in this parameter space, there is a map in this reconstructed energy zenith map space. And so what we basically going to try to do is, given the data, which of these maps fits the best with some nuisance parameters and so on and so forth. But this is basically the idea. Okay. It's important to note that we want to look for order 10% effect. So that's more or less the size of our signal. And for that, it's important to consider the statistical errors that our sample is going to have. So we are going to use 1 year of samples, so around 20,000 events. This is the binning that we are going to use. And so in the region of interest is going to be the MSW region. It's around 3, it's around log 10 energy of 3, so one around a TeV. And so in that region of interest, our statistical errors are going to go between 10% and like 4%. And so it's going to be enough to measure this very particular, it's a very particular correlation we're going to look for. It's going to give us quite a lot of power. But that also means that what we have tried to achieve in this analysis is to control systematic uncertainties to the 10% level. And systematics in this analysis are very important. Some of them are going to be more important than others, of course. And so we try to parameterize all the possible systematics that we could think about. And so here I have more or less listed all of them in order and importance. So one of the most important systematics is going to be the actual efficiency of our DOMs, which is not a completely certain quantity. Then we have the uncertainties in the atmospheric flux, cosmic ray shower uncertainties, uncertainties on the ice, and so on and so forth. I'm going to go to a couple of these just to simplify. So first, let me tell you what atmospheric flux dominates in this particular region. So atmospheric flux in the stellar analysis is basically dominated by the kaon component. So you can assume that most of the neutrinos actually come from kaon decay. And there is going to be a subdominant component that's given the pion decay, which is this red line. Prompt, so which are mesons, char mesons decays, are going to be totally subleading. So we are going to assume that our atmospheric neutrino flux has two components. One is the one from originating from kaon decay, and one originating from pion decay. So what we did is we took a bunch of cosmic ray models. So this is the cosmic ray spectrum in the region of interest, more or less like power law, which is 10 to the 5, below 10 to the 5 GeV in primary energy. So we took a couple of cosmic ray models, and then we took a couple of hadronic models, and we solve the cascade equation for each of these combination of hadronic model and cosmic ray model to calculate the yield of pion and kaon neutrino fluxes. And we did this for these six combinations, and then we also took the Honda-Geiser model, which has also some predictions of the expected pion and kaon components. And then when we said, well, our atmospheric flux is going to be parametrized by basically adding the pion and kaon components, there is some relative uncertainty in how big these two components should be, so we allow for a nuisance parameter to gauge this uncertainty. It's going to be a Gaussian nuisance parameter. And then to account for the uncertainty in the cosmic ray slope, which in this energy race is a very good approximation by a power law, we account for this through this spectral index shift. And then the overall normalization of the atmospheric flux is going to actually float initially we let the flow before the prior, and then we're going to discuss the case where we constrain that. Then the DOM efficiency of the detector, well, the efficiency of DOM is not precisely known, and what actually matters is the precision, is the actual, I'm sorry, efficiency of the DOM when it's coupled to the ice, and there is a cable around the DOM that actually changes the overall precision altogether when you consider the DOM. So this is what this is going to do, is going to shift your energy distribution as you increase or decrease your DOM efficiency, and it has a sublevering zenith dependence too. Then the other thing we discuss is the uncertainty is given to the ice. So the ice has different absorption scattering coefficients as you go as function of depth. And we have measured this through calibration runs. And we have a bunch of models that explain most of the features that we think are in the ice. And the way we try to estimate the uncertainty in the ice in this particular analysis is we took our benchmark model and then we increase its absorption by 10%, so 10% extra photon absorption, and then separately with the plus 10% scattering of the photons. And that gives us these changes in the expected event number. So you can see that more or less, but if you do that, it's a very featureless change in the TEV regime, and it's a 4% change, and so it's smaller than our statistical uncertainty. So we think that by just considering these discrete variations of the ice possibilities, we cover the uncertainties in the ice. And then there is another effect, which is the whole ice. So basically what happens is that when we drill the hole and we put the water back in, it has some air bubbles, and these air bubbles are going to increase the scattering in the direction of the where the hole has been drilled. And this is going to scatter photons, and then what's going to happen is the relative efficiency of our DOMs along the direction that's pointed out by the red arrow is going to be decreased. So we have a bunch of models that try to parameterize this effect, and we have also the expectation where this effect doesn't happen, so that's the no-hole ice expectation. So what we did in this analysis, we basically looked at the difference between having this effect and not having this effect, and it turns out that this is a small difference, so we just consider two scenarios. Okay. So this was a blind analysis, so we did a bunch of pre and blinding checks. We fitted for a null hypothesis in the whole sample, so we didn't see it. And then we look at the projection, so that did not allow us to look at this specific correlation, and didn't see it, so blindness was preserved. These are the energy and zenith distributions. You can see they are pretty good fits. The red line is the no sterile neutrino hypothesis. So we found that we had a very reasonable chi-square, and the nuisance parameters, the atmospheric nuisance parameters, and so on and so forth, they all come out to have reasonable values. So they give us green light to forward. We look at the pools per bean on the no sterile hypothesis, which is shown in this plot here. This distribution has about 200 beams, and in these 200 beams there are 5 or 6 plus 2 sigma fluctuations, which is compatible with the expectation of statistical fluctuation. We have tested that this is quite a compatible realization, and so this is again fine. So before I go forward to getting the main result, let me acknowledge my two co-analyzers. One was Ben Jones, who was at MIT, he's now at UT Arlington. And the other one is Jorge S Diaz, who was at UW-Mayo, so now he's now at the FIC Valencia. And so we decided to open the box, and we found no significant evidence for sterile neutrino, and this allowed us to place new bounds. So in this diagram, in this plot here, you see our result for 90% confidence level in what we call the shape-only analysis, where the normalization of the atmospheric flux is allowed to float freely. Of course, when you do this analysis in this parameter space, you're going to find a best fit point somewhere. So we actually found it at this delta m squared 10 and sin squared theta 0.56, which is up there in the corner in this parameter space. And this particular point happens to be a very likely realization of the no sterile hypothesis. What we did with the following exercise, so we using Monte Carlo, we generated samples compatible to null hypothesis, and then we fitted it using our software, and then we see what delta m squared and sin squared we obtain, and that gives you the distribution of points that you see in the right diagram here, And so you see most of the solutions cluster around this upper corner. And so what's happening there is that in this high delta M square regime, the oscillations are going to be very fast. So they are going to average out, which is kind of exemplifying this little diagram down there. And so they're going to be basically indistinguishable from the null hypothesis, right? And so sometimes the null hypothesis will fit a little better than the other one. And this happens 19% of the time. So it's a very quiet, it's a very typical minima location. So then, of course, we are in this high delta M square regime, which where the normalization prior pulls to normalization value pulls to close to 2. So we said, well, what happens if we put posteriori and 40% prior to normalization? And so one can see that the sensitivities of putting and not putting the priors are actually the same, but the result is weakened slightly. So here in this plot, you know, shape only, we put no prior in the normalization. Normalization can be whatever it wants. Right, but shape normalization is all constrained to within 40% of what Honda says. And then the red lines, So the solid lines are the right by shape, so that's the width prior, and the dashed lines are the shape only result, so it's weakened, and the reason it's weakened is like we have a likelihood problem in the shape only case, so we solve this likelihood problem and we obtain the solution in this upper corner. Then we put a posteriori a prior that's in tension with this particular solution, and that makes the likelihood problem worse, and we get a weaker bound. Okay. So we can compare this to our expectation, and this is the Brazilian plots that make as a function of mass. So for each fixed delta M squared, you have the median sensitivity and the expected 60% and 95% bands that contain the median sensitivity. You see that this is very compatible with the with what we actually get from the data, which is the red line. So how does this compare with other measurements? Here is the all these appearance results at 90%. Here you have minus super K, CHS, minimum Cygon. And you can see that in the 1 to 0.1 EV range, we have improved the constraints on this parameter by about one order of magnitude. So that's pretty neat. So now, how does this look? If we look now with the LSD minimum balloon, which is extracted from Copetol. So here I have the shape and shape plus rate results, and you can see that in both cases, at 99% confidence level, the mini-wounds side-wound combination from Copetol is excluded at 90% confidence level. Okay, so we have performed search for eV-Sterile neutrinos. We found no significant evidence. We improved the world limits by about one order of magnitude in that mass range of between 0.1 and 1 Thomas squared. And actually, IceCube has more years of data rate to analyze, and we're just getting started. We're working on follow-up analysis. And for more details, please see this paper on the archive. So, thank you.
Thank you, Carlos, for this very interesting seminar. Let's see if we have questions on the this first check for the people in the connected to the Hangout.
Yeah, I have a question for Carlos.
Yeah.
So, Carlos,
yeah.
It's very naive in the sense, do you expect, when, because in your analysis, you assume that you fit your CP phases to zero for the sterile neutrino with the active and everything. So do you expect that non-zero CP phases would have an impact in your analysis, or could be a kind of?
So the CP phases tend to cancel. There are two other effects. So there, okay, there are two angles that have made zero, and I have also made zero the CP phases. The two angles I made zero, there's a theta 3-4 angle, and theta 3-4 angle does have some effect on the result, but it can be shown that setting it to zero is actually the conservative thing to do. The CP phase, the standard three neutrino CP phase doesn't play a role here. But the sterile neutrino CP phases do play a role, but a subleading role to the theta 3-4 angle. And actually, because we have an addition of neutrinos and antineutrinos, and the CP phase acts in opposite ways, it tends to cancel the CP phase effect. So it's a subleading effect. But, okay, so the reason we also took this particular model is that it's quite a benchmark model, so it's very simple to interpret. But of course, it's now the task of the global fitters to discuss this. For example, let me here. There is this balloon here, right? This LSMD minimum balloon, and so this balloon. So LSMD minimum measures new mean to new oscillations, right? And so they are measuring this combination, which I put here, which is sine squared 2 theta mu e, which is the product of these matrix elements. We are measuring, actually, sine squared 2 theta mu e, which is the product of these elements here, right? So to say that you exclude it or not, you know, you need to assume. So for me to be able to put the LSMD minimum in this angle, I have to assume a value of ue4. And so the way we do it, so we take ue4 to the best fit value according to Cope et al., which is this number. Now you can always, of course, make ue4 a bigger number. And so what that does, it makes the minimum Cybun balloon move to smaller angles in this sine squared 2 theta to 4, and that then escapes the 99% level bound. But of course, if you do that, you increase the mix, the disappearance of the EE sectors, which have more constraints from them coming from reactors. So there are tensions. I mean, there are effects of the other angles in the overall problem, right? But this is something that that the global fits community has to sort out because of the many pulls that's coming from different directions, right? And actually, me and Janet Conrad's groups, we are working on updating our global feed, so it incorporates also the IceCube information.
Thank you. And another short question, because this is kind of, really I don't know what can be done with IceCube, I mean, in the sense of all the possible different scenarios that you can cover, but are there other type of physics beyond known physics that can mimic the same signature that there are neutrinos in your, I mean, can you have some caveats in your analysis that can be used not only to constrain stellar neutrinos, but other type of physics?
So is your question, let me try to understand this. Is your question is, are there any systematic that could mimic the signal, or standard models, or some physics systematic that could mimic the signal? Or is your question, is there other new physics that looks similar to
that? If there are other new physics that can mimic the signal, apart from stellar neutrinos.
Well, I don't know all the new physics possibilities, because there are, of course, too many. But yeah, this is a very concrete MSW-looking feature, right? So the deep is very, the effect is very characteristic. Because it follows this MSW resonance condition, right? So in that sense, it's rather specific. But this energy range between, you know, hundreds of GeVs to a couple of TeVs or tens of TeVs, we have a lot of data there. We have tens of thousands of events. And so, of course, this data will constrain more and more. So, for example, NSIs can be constrained also, which is something we are working on. And Lorentz violation, for example, can also be constrained using the upper the uppermost tail of this sample can be also constrained, which is something we are also working on.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Anybody else on the final lecture? Ask anything to Carlos. I do have a question for you, Carlos, if I can go with it. So one of the questions that I have is that you mentioned, and it's of course well known, that the matter potential changes for when you have neutrinos or anti-neutrinos, right?
Yeah.
You can show the formula there. So the question I have is, how do you separate neutrinos from anti-neutrinos in IceCube in order to use appropriately this formula?
So, event-by-event basis, we cannot separate neutrinos and anti-neutrinos. Of course, statistically speaking, they will look slightly different in the detector, right? But the issue is that we measure the sum of neutrinos and anti-neutrinos. And the sum will be modified when you have the anti-neutrino component have the MSW effect. So actually, in our sample, So the initial atmospheric neutrino-antineutrino ratio is about an order one number. But the neutrino-antineutrino cross-section, neutrino cross-section is a factor of, about a factor of two larger than the antineutrino one.
Yeah.
And so that makes the sample has about 30% of the sample is antineutrinos and 70% of the sample, more or less, is are neutrinos. And so basically you will only have the effect on the 30% of the sample, right? Now, of course, I can switch my stellar neutrino model, so it's not 3 plus 1, but 1 plus 3. So I switch the sign of delta m square. And in that case, the resonance happens in neutrinos, right? But neutrinos, we have more than antineutrinos, say.
Mm-hmm.
And so the effect will be enhanced, right? Or a larger effect. So we expect that the constraints will be even stronger in that scenario. Yeah, but we cannot distinguish them. I guess my point is we cannot distinguish them event per event.
Yeah, that's
but
what
of course on the distributions we can definitely if there is a difference in one of them we can take it apart.
So you can basically separate them in a statistical way. Is it similar to what Supercoming Candidate does?
Not quite. I mean, we add the components together, right?
Okay.
We don't have a really we don't have like a this analysis doesn't use like a like, for example, a boosted decision tree or whatever to try to separate them, right? No, we just add them to and then we look at the sum.
I see. Okay. There is one question from the Q&A system. It was sent by Mauricio Bustamante, but he said, this is a question from Jose Carpio in Lima. He says, I do not understand why you introduce a 40% normalization prior post-unblinding.
Well, that's a good question. I mean, the analysis, as it was designed prior to unblinding, was thought to be a shape-only analysis. So we did not constrain normalization of atmospheric flux. Then a posteriori, we decided that it was a good idea to incorporate the information of the atmospheric flux. So we look at the literature to see what is the quoted uncertainty in the atmospheric neutrino normalization flux. And so that turns out to be this 40% number. And so I think it's valid if you have information you can certainly include in the problem. But yeah, this number, this 40% comes out of the literature. So we didn't just pick it, you know, randomly.
I see.
It is actually a very well-justified number.
So, Jose, if you're connected, I hope that answers your question. If not, you still have some time, so you can send them the question again. I do have actually another question. So, when people talk about stellar neutrinos, sometimes they get confused with the idea that sometimes you have this, say, a 3 plus 1 model, and there are many constraints on this 3 plus 1 model. And when people say from talking about a reactor anomaly, they talk about the stellar neutrino. And when people consider, say, the cosmological bounds, they say that there is room for another, for a stellar neutrino. So which of all these stellar neutrinos is the one that you're talking about here?
I'm a little confused. So, I mean, the reactor anomaly and the LSND anomaly both point to the same type of neutrinos, so these eV square scale neutrinos.
Mm-hmm.
Cosmology doesn't like per se these neutrinos. So if you take like standard lambda CDM cosmology and standard stellar neutrino, you will see that there is a tension between the stellar neutrino solution that the LSND likes and cosmology, right? But this is, of course, assuming, you know, lambda CDM and assuming that the stellar neutrino is just, you know, the minimal stellar neutrino, we'll call it, right? But stellar neutrinos, of course, as being VSM particles, may come with extra VSM physics that may change the game. So I actually have a slide that I got from Georg Raphael, but let me see if I find it. That kind of represents this issue, right? So he got this from Hannestad. You can see that if you take more cosmological data and you just stick with lambda CDM, you know, you can get quite strong constraints on the sound of neutrino masses, and that would be quite in big tension with the having a 1 eV square stellar neutrino, right? But of course, the issue is that you are adding data sets in different ways, And then it turns out there is this other axis, which is what he calls the model space, right? So if you add new physics, you know, this can be interpreted in different ways. Okay. So if you like lambda CDM and put all the data, the bounds are like around 0.2 or so, and it's got quite a big tension with the standard stellar neutrino thing. But of course, both cosmology and stellar and particle physics could be different, and that makes this okay.
Yeah, I see. There is one more question from the Q&A from Diego Restrepo. He says the point limit on the number of neutrinos now pointing towards 3 instead of 4 impose any constraint on the LS&D anomaly?
Yeah, again, this is again the same point, right? I mean, yes, cosmology lately doesn't like stellar neutrinos. So if you take that one in particular related to also the Hubble parameter, right? So it depends how strongly do you take these cosmological bounds and results, right? Yeah, but it certainly doesn't favor it, Colonia.
Okay, so
I have a question.
Roberto.
It's just an maybe you said it during the talk. How much do you think that is going to be the improvement on the bounds that you found with, I don't know, in 10 years of the IceCube, when IceCube is going to be at the end? I don't know how much you expect that this bound improves.
So we're under currently studying because of course as you accumulate statistics or make bigger analysis, systematics that were subleading and not so important now become very relevant, right? So this analysis is not statistically limited but systematically limited, right? And in those cases, it's difficult to predict exactly where we will end up with. I don't have a plot or a benchmark number to give you, but I do have. Let me see if I find it. I do have this slide that tells you what we are thinking of, how we can go forward, and we're going to go forward in two ways. One way we're doing it is we're going to do this analysis using now 5 years of data which we have in disk, and of course, what I was saying, when you put more statistics, you know, systematic like the eyes become more important, so you have to deal with them a little more carefully. And another way to go forward is to select better events, right? So for that, for example, we can select only starting events, and we have a better neutrino energy reconstruction, so we can actually have information not only on the track energy, but the shower energy that improves our energy proxy, let's say. Of course, you pay a price because in your statistics is reduced because you're selecting better events, right? So we're trying both approaches. We're studying which one will be better in the end, and so it's at the moment understudy what will be the future, but we have ideas like this. And the data is there. The data is certainly on disk. So we just have to work hard.
Okay, so anybody else has any question? If not, well, we thank Carlos again and all the viewers of this seminar. And see you next time to another Latin American webinar on physics.
Okay, thank you.
Bye, Carlos. Thanks again.
Bye.